The following program is brought to you by Total Theater Online. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the staff or management of WGBB. You're listening to the station that serves your community, 1240 WGBB. And now it's time for Dave's Gone By with David Lefkowitz.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Dave's Gone By. Talk radio, comedy, interviews, music, and spewsic coming to you live with 1,000 watts of Chinese power, or so they say, on the radio and on the web, WGBB and AM 1240 WGBB on Long Island. If you can't get the station where you are, how are you listening to me now? But if you can get the station, only it's coming in...
not like a thin, gentle, steady stream of urine, but like splats of nut-filled diarrhea hitting your ears. Fear not. Put away your old wireless, pick up your computer, sling it over your shoulder, and find the URL WGBB.com. Once you're there, click the button for online radio, wait a minute or two, and if the good creek's willing and the Lord don't rise, you'll hear Dave's Gone By live streaming on the internet, clear and pure as waters from the mountains of Fiji to the fountains of a squeegee. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to ride the wave of Dave. That's me, Dave Lefkowitz, radio personality, humorist, journalist, critic, and songwriter, and this is my show, Dave's Gone By. We're calling this one 30-something because it's our 30th episode, and I think that's something. Still building our audience, still making a name for ourselves in the community, still trying to get across what the show is about and what we do here every week. And what's interesting is that when I first started thinking of doing a radio show about a year ago now, when I first said to myself, you know, I really want to be on the air, I really want to share my opinions and music and sense of humor, I have some radio experience and I think I have something to offer, I started mulling over what kind of show to do. And the first thing that came to mind was theater. Theater has been my career and calling for 2 decades now. And although there are a couple of theater-related programs scattered on the radio dial, especially if you listen on the net, there really aren't any with my perspective and the mix of elements that I would bring to it. So I put together what I thought was an entertaining and viable idea and started talking to radio people about it. Radio people who had done it, either for syndication or for larger stations than this one. And they all said the same thing. Don't do it. Nobody wants it. The audience is too small, too niche. And I said, wait, the audience may not be the size it is for Howard Stern or Justin Timberlake or Mike Artsis, but it's bigger than just a handful. And it's also an affluent audience, people who have discretionary income to spend going to shows. My colleague said, that's all well and good, but program directors don't care. Station owners don't care. It's the wrong demographic. You'd be going after people 35 to 70. They want 18 to 30, and that's all they want. And if you explain to them that the middle-aged and elderly population is a lot bigger and more prosperous than college sophomores, they just look at you like that guy in Private Parts, WNBC. So I had serious second thoughts about doing a theater show, because the demographic was wrong, the audience might not be there, and the few radio stations that might think about syndicating such a program already were. And a radio host I know who does a show about theater, food, and travel said his first love was theater, but he had to add the other stuff to get any advertising. Because ad agencies for Broadway shows, he said, won't even talk to you, and restaurants in the theater district keep their advertising local. He wasn't the only one to give me this advice, so I seriously reconsidered doing a theater show, which led me to a revelation. I didn't have to. Much as I love the theater, as people who listen to Dave's Gone By every week surely know, much as I'm a Broadway and off-Broadway geek, that's not the only facet of my personality. It's not the only thing I want to get across on the radio. I like show tunes, but I like rock and roll better. I love a good play more than anything, but I also like good movies, TV, books, and I like being funny, doing sketches, monologues, and I enjoy interviewing people. I'm pretty good at it, but I don't always want to be interviewing just theater people. So I put all this together, and I said, if I'm going to do a show, let me go all the way and do the dream I want. Let me fit in all the stuff I want to share. The music, the comedy, the interviews, the rants, the sketches. Each show will be a little different, but yet some things will also happen regularly, so there's a sense of cohesion. And what'll hold it together is me. My personality and whatever charisma or wit or desperation makes me unique and keeps people listening. Just the way David Letterman can go from monologue to interview to musical guest. Just the way an MC can host a talent show of everything from a ventriloquist to jugglers and make it feel fluid and harmonious. With that in mind, I put together a new concept for a show. The original title was going to be These Foolish Things, which I liked. But my wife thought up Dave's Gone By, which just immediately stuck. And since October 6th, last year, that's what I've been doing Sunday nights on WGBB. We moved from late night to prime time. We're building listeners. We have many members of the Bystanders Club, the official fan club. And now when I talk to radio colleagues about the format, the same ones who said a theater show was too restrictive, too narrow in format for advertising, now they're telling me my format's too diffuse. Now they're saying advertisers need a niche so they can directly target the market they want to reach. Well, which is it, guys? Elephant gun or blow dart? The moral of the story, I guess, is beware the counsel of colleagues who are well-meaning but also protecting their own turf. But the other moral is don't be afraid to go whole hog. I don't know if I'd have been as happy if I'd just done a theater show. And I doubt I have the listenership and devoted fan base that I do if I only did Broadway and show tunes and let's talk to this actor every week. So while, yes, I and the station are busy scouting up advertisers and sponsors for this program, and if you're interested, check the website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. The ad rates and opportunities are all there, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. Now that we're getting established, now that we have name recognition, now's the time we're really going after ads and sponsors so we can take it to the next level. Expand the show, maybe do some live performances at local clubs, have more gift giveaways. All it takes is a little more support and backing, and we're on our way. I bring this up not just to push for new advertisers, but to let you know, if this is your first time listening, what an eclectic and fun show this can be every week. And also to let the theater fans know that far from abandoning the stage, Dave's Gone By does theater segments 2 or 3 times a month, including reviews, interviews, commentary. Last week we played selections from Jesus Christ Superstar. Next week, fingers crossed, we have an interview with critic and author Jonathan Kalb. He has a new book out of his writings for the New York Press and the Village Voice. Very articulate and interesting. Definitely tune in. And tonight, I'm going to report on 3 Broadway musicals that just opened in the past couple of weeks, which are the winners, the losers, the in-betweeners. I'll let you know. And if you're not into theater, stay tuned anyway, because as always, we have the news gone by, current events from a sideways perspective, and we have a bunch this week, so stay tuned. Plus, music from the Everly Brothers to Karen Akers to a singing snail. So strap yourselves in, hang up that cell phone, put down that remote. The news gone by will start 60 seconds from now. If you're a good American, that means you like to own things. Well, now's your chance. You can own a piece of my show. That's right, Dave's Gone By is ready to promote you. If you have a product, event, or service to hawk shamelessly, you can buy 30 or 60 seconds of advertising time on my show. You can even be a sponsor. Just imagine. This week's News Gone By is brought to you by you. We'll be right back after this word from your product. Advertising on Dave's Gone By is cost-effective and reaches listeners not only on Long Island, but thanks to WGBB.com all over the world. To get a piece of the Dave, call 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com. To see our disgustingly low ad rates, check our website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. Remember, you could be talking to you right now. Are you listening? Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. It's 8:11 p.m. and time for the news gone by. A look at events of the past week from a sarcastic perspective. In post-war news, President George Bush gave his first lengthy interview since the conflict began. He said, American soldiers are still looking for weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. And he told NBC News, quote, Saddam Hussein tried to fool the United Nations and did for 12 years by hiding those weapons. And so it's going to take some time to find them. And whether he destroyed them, moved them, or hid them, we're going to find out the truth. And Bush said it was entirely possible that Hussein destroyed all his chemical and biological weapons before the invasion started. Excuse me, but isn't that what we asked him to do? Didn't we say get rid of all your weapons of mass destruction or else we'll bomb you? Hussein said there weren't any. The UN inspectors couldn't find any, and our soldiers haven't turned up any. Well, maybe he did. Now, again, I don't think anybody's sorry to see Saddam Hussein out of power, but any illusions of this war being just about bioterrorism are totally out the window. It's like the owners of the Detroit Tigers sending all the players down to AAA and telling them, oh, it's because your mustaches are distracting the fans. And all of them saying, but we don't have mustaches. And the owner saying, oh, yes, you do, we think, but you also suck. So bye! Meanwhile, in Iraq, thousands of Shiite Muslims marched through the streets of Karbala, Iraq, on Tuesday in a religious pilgrimage, the kind that had been outlawed by Saddam Hussein since 1977. The last time the Shiites made such a procession, Hussein cracked down and rioting broke out. Dozens of people were killed by the government, with sect leaders arrested and executed. Now, with Hussein toppled from power by the U.S., and the Muslims free to express their religious convictions thanks to American intervention, the Shiites paraded through Karbala chanting, yes to Islam, no to America, no to Israel, and no to occupation. Well, I'm no cleric, but I do think our soldiers over there should have their own religious chant, no to water, no to food, no to oil, and yes to starvation and chaos, you helpless, ungrateful bastards. Good luck to you. In local news, remember late last year when the transit workers threatened to go on strike and the MTA pleaded poverty and scolded the union for demanding more money in harsh economic times? And you remember a few months ago when everyone was distracted by Iraq, so the MTA rammed through fare increases by screaming poverty and scolding politicians for not understanding how much it costs to run subways and buses? And remember when commuters hoped the rate hikes would be reasonable, instead of $2 for bus and subway fares, plus big increases on Metro North and the Long Island Railroad? And remember how the MTA pleaded poverty and threatened draconian service cuts if they didn't get everything they wanted? And remember this Wednesday, when auditors for New York State discovered that the MTA was keeping two sets of accounting books, one for the public, almost $1 billion in debt, the other, for internal use only, showing them in far better shape. They had shrunk their deficit in half by restructuring the debt, but didn't tell anyone. And remember Thursday, when Controller Alan Hevesy demanded that the Transit Authority repeal the fare increases scheduled to take effect next Sunday? And remember how the MTA refused because, well, they just refused. And remember when the public held a massive protest outside the MTA offices that turned into a riot, with people setting fire to the building and beating the hell out of Chairman Peter Calico, dragging his body to the nearest subway station and throwing him under an F train? You don't remember that? Give it a few days. In How Drunk Do You Have to Be news, how drunk do you have to be to do what Paul Russell, age 33, did last week in Syracuse? He and a friend were being tipsy and disorderly at a bar, so a policeman was called to help them exit. Russell didn't take kindly to that, so he grabbed the policeman's dog, a 3-year-old German Shepherd, and started choking it and biting the side of its neck. The cop punched Russell in the face to make him stop, giving him a broken nose and 2 black eyes. Asked why he did what he did, Russell told the Associated Press, this is a quote, I don't think I bit the dog. I just got into a fight with him. I don't really remember. I was pretty drunk. Oh, yeah, that'll sound good in court. What Russell didn't say is that he gave the Shepherd his phone number and told her she was much better looking than all the other dogs in the bar. Speaking of man versus dog, let's hear it for Dosha, an 8-month-old mixed breed from Clear Lake, California. A week ago, Dosha was hit by a car. A police officer arrived on the scene and decided to put the mutt out of her misery. So he shot Dosha in the head. He then transported the carcass to animal control, where they locked her in a freezer. The control center's director checked on the dog 2 hours later, only to discover that Dosha was still alive. She had hypothermia and a gunshot wound, but ironically only superficial wounds from the car accident. Asked if the cop who shot Dosha had responded properly to the incident, the L.A. chief of police said absolutely. In fact, now we know what to do the next time we get a Rodney King. In, oh look, an idiot news, Republican Senator Rick Santorum spent the week trying to clarify remarks he made about homosexuality. Using classic political doublespeak, Santorum told the Associated Press, quote, I have no problem with homosexuality. I have a problem with homosexual acts. I'll read that again. I have no problem with homosexuality, he said. I have a problem with homosexual acts, just as I would with acts outside of traditional heterosexual relationships. I have no problem with someone who has other orientations. The question is, do you act upon those orientations? Asked to clarify his position, Santorum said, I'm a bottom. Also in political news, Parliament member and former anti-apartheid leader Winnie Mandela has been convicted of more than 60 counts of theft and fraud. She apparently used her position as head of the Women's League of the African National Congress to float bogus bank loans for non-existent employees. Not surprisingly, opposition leader Douglas Gibson called for her resignation, saying, quote, a member of Parliament convicted on 43 charges of fraud should not stay on in Parliament. Never stopped a politician before, but before now it hadn't even stopped Mandela. In 1991, she was convicted of kidnapping and accessory to assault in connection with the death of a 14-year-old township activist. She was sentenced to 6 years in prison, reduced on appeal to just a fine. Asked about his ex-wife's endeavors, Nelson Mandela reserved comment, though he did say that as a Marxist, stealing from banks is not fraud, it's heroism, and kidnapping children isn't kidnapping, it's sharing the youth. And finally, in politics, after 4 years of painstaking research, in which they examined over 16,000 FBI documents from the Watergate era, students at the University of Illinois announced that they've discovered the identity of Deep Throat. They think it was White House Deputy Counsel and Assistant to John Dean, Fred Fielding. See, this is what's wrong with colleges today. Hours of misguided work and research totally unconnected to the real world. Everybody knows the identity of Deep Throat was Linda Lovelace. She had this thing in her voice box that allowed her to... Well, anyway, I'm sorry, those kids fail. I'll bet they go on to spend another 4 years on an Indian reservation researching the Battle of Wounded Knee, when all they need to do is consult an arthroscopic surgeon. Kids. Well, since this is going to be a very theater-related show, here's a little theater news from London. La Fura del Baus, a Spanish theater company whose name literally means the fury from the sewer, has just opened a show called XXX, nothing to do with Vin Diesel, at London's Riverside Studio. The play is loosely based on a book by the Marquis de Sade and features a cast of naked libertines reenacting sexual fantasies and perversions. It's considered the most sexually explicit work ever to open in Britain, although the sex on stage is all simulated, allowing the show to skirt past the vice squad. Still, we're not talking about a nipple here, a nut there. The play apparently features scenes of sodomy, rape, incest, genital mutilation, sex with baked beans, a defecating anus, and even a man having sex with a Shetland pony. Video screens play actual hardcore pornography, including one sequence where two vaginas hold a conversation while puffing on cigarettes. Audience members can volunteer to be stripped or beaten or have their fantasies acted out. The play apparently ends with a young girl at the center of the story organizing a gang rape of her own mother. Now, the theater company's artistic director told the press, and this is a quote, I thought very long and hard about staging the show. I'm telling you, that's a quote. But it's an honest piece of theater, and it leaves you thinking in the end. Yes, but whose end? But seriously, at this point, there are no plans to bring XXX to Broadway. However, the Disney people have expressed interest in turning the material into a musical. Alan Menken and Stephen Schwartz are collaborating on a score that includes such songs as Beauty and the Beast and Another Beast, When You Whip Upon a Scar, Aida and then Aida Some More, Bibbidi Bobbidi Blow, Hakuna Matata Vagina Dentata, and an homage to Cats, Puff the Magic Pussy. They'll also be reviving a couple of classic Disney numbers that won't be changed, Bare Necessities and Bedknobs and Broomsticks. In less graphic theater news, Denny Doherty, an original member of the Mamas and the Papas, has crafted an off-Broadway show about his experiences with the group. Dream a Little Dream, now playing at the Village Theater, tells of the wild ups and heavy downs of the pop quartet, with Doherty himself, backed by other vocalists, singing songs the group made famous. I haven't seen the show, but the reviews have been pretty good. One or two critics complain that Doherty's a little narcissistic and that his memories are a tad self-important for his place in the group. I wanted to check for myself, so I got a transcript of his narration, and it does have a kind of self-absorbed focus. Here's an example. Doherty says, "So the money kept coming, and John kept doing more drugs. He was away, so I had a fling with Michelle Phillips. Then John wrote Monday Monday. We put out another album, and I was still sleeping with Michelle Phillips. While John was writing Words of Love, Michelle and I were doing like every sexual position imaginable. Mama Cass was hot for me, but hey, I was boinking Michelle Phillips. So John came back and wrote Midnight Voyage. I told him I was humping Michelle, and he was like, oh. And then Mama Cass choked on a chicken sandwich and died. Did I mention I banged Michelle Phillips? I did, really. Sunday nights at 7, it's a new spin on old-fashioned radio when Don Lewis hosts Entertainment Long Island. It's an hour of interviews and advice about how to get started as a performer, be it as a career or a hobby. Every show has nostalgia, humor, and live music by Eddie Hug and the boys, so catch the corny jokes and talented folks on Entertainment Long Island right before Dave's Gone By. It all starts Sunday night at 7 on WGBB because the stage is a world of entertainment. Every Saturday night at 7:30, right here on WGBB, it's Joe Salzone Live. Tell us about it, Joe.
Well, Dave, it's a half-hour, fast-paced glimpse at the world we live in.
Joe Salzone brings his old-fashioned, conservative views, along with his desire to hear all viewpoints, to the airwaves each week. It's a one-of-a-kind show that you'll hear only on Long Island's news and information leader,
1240 AM WGBB,
the station that serves your community. Welcome back to the News Gone By segment of Dave's Gone By. I don't feel well. Those were the words of Lawrence Schlosser, a Manhattan real estate dealer rescued by 911 after being imprisoned under the floorboards of a Tribeca loft. According to the Daily News, Schlosser met with his business partner, Lawrence Omansky, in Omansky's apartment. They had words, which turned into uglier words, which turned into Omansky pulling a knife on Schlosser. Omansky then tied up his 63-year-old partner and threw him down a trapdoor. For 28 hours, Schlosser lay in a crawl space without food, no water, until he was finally able to break free of the duct tape binding him. He then found a metal pipe and kept bashing on a trapdoor until it opened. Then Schlosser climbed back into the apartment and called the cops. Asked how he's been coping since the ordeal, Schlosser said he'd barely been able to eat and admitted he might need therapy to deal with the experience. The good news for Schlosser is that although the crawl space, which the Daily News dubbed a horror hole, is dark, tiny, dangerous, and now stinks of human waste, it is in a prime New York location and worth $400,000 on the co-op market. Some crime news with a less happy ending. 33-year-old Robert Ambrosino was upset that his girlfriend, Lyric Benson, a Yale graduate and budding actress, broke off their engagement 2 months ago. So Robert waited outside Lyric's Chinatown apartment on Thursday and, with Lyric's mother watching, shot the girl, then turned the gun on himself. Robert died instantly. Lyric is being kept alive just to harvest her organs. Lyric's mother, of course, is distraught, though she has received condolences from unlikely sources, including the producers of the Broadway flop Dance of the Vampires. They expressed sympathy, but also relief. After all, they said, "We thought our lyrics were in bad shape, but look at yours." Yes, that's the comedy bell signaling the Dave's Gone By bad pun of the week, brought to you as a public service by the Dave's Gone By radio show. Every week we make 1, 2, 3, or even 4 bad puns during the course of the evening. There is no cause for alarm, but you may hear the comedy bell. If so, it's a reminder that you've just heard the bad pun of the week, which is, coincidentally and completely by design, available for sponsorship. You can have your product, business, or service linked to a terrible play on words and then brought to listeners' attention in a pitch just like this. The rates are cheap, the method is memorable, the results remarkable. So advertise on the Dave's Gone By show by sponsoring the bad pun of the week. Call 516-295-1511 to find out how. 516-295-1511. Get a pen and write that down so you can get a pun and write that up. 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com for the rates and the easy details. Remember, we're on the radio and the internet, so you can reach listeners all over Long Island and New York and across the USA. 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com to sponsor the Dave's Gone By bad pun of the week. Continuing the News Gone By, congratulations to Japanese scientists who have solved one of the great, long-standing questions of the universe. Why did God invent parsley? I mean, it kind of looks nice as a garnish, but it's always the first thing you pull off a dish and toss off the side of your plate. And every once in 10 years, you try it. You chew a piece, and you go, Oh, that's why I don't eat parsley. But that may change, thanks to scientists in Japan who have discovered the first new vitamin in 55 years. It's nicknamed PQQ. And when mice were deprived of it, their fertility went down and their fur turned rough. Now, vitamins are defined, by the way, as any organic substance that contributes to health and growth, but it has to come from food. It's not something your body makes itself. How do you get PQQ? Kiwi, papaya, green peppers, green tea, and parsley. Isn't it nice to know that God found a purpose for something we all thought was completely and utterly useless? And I'm sure in the next 10 years, scientists will find some value, some reason for the existence of ragweed, cockroaches, mosquitoes, and the French. Sad news in publishing. After 102 years in business, the magazine Travel Holiday is shutting down. The publishers, Hachette Filippacci Media, blame the book's demise on, quote, the tough economic and geopolitical climate taking its toll on advertising. On the plus side, Hachette will begin publishing a pamphlet more in keeping with Americans' current travel plans. It's called, I'm Going Next Door for a Cup of Sugar, Please Don't Cough on Me or Blow Up My House. Sad news from the music world. Farewell to lyricist Felice Bryant, who, with her husband, Boudelot Bryant, co-wrote more than 800 songs, recorded by everyone from Bobby Darin to Sarah Vaughan to the Grateful Dead. Bryant died on Tuesday, aged 77. Her husband had died back in 1987. He wrote some songs himself, including All I Have to Do Is Dream and Love Hurts, but together, her words, his music, they created such classics as Take a Message to Mary, Ringing in My Heart, and Wake Up Little Susie, and this other Everly Brothers standard, Bye Bye Love.
There goes my baby with someone new. She sure looks happy, I sure am blue. She was my baby till he stepped in. Goodbye to romance that might have been. Bye-bye, my love, goodbye. I'm through with romance, I'm through with love, I'm through with counting the stars above. And there's a reason that I'm so free. My loving baby is through with me.
Bye bye love and bye bye Louise Bryant. Thanks for all the music. Closing the news gone by, we bid a less fond farewell to Charlie Douglas, the 93-year-old inventor of the television laugh track. Douglas, who died on April 8th, was working as a technical director when he came up with the idea to sweeten or invent laughter on TV comedies to make them seem funnier than they actually are. His original machine was called the Laugh Box. It used recordings of audiences at Marcel Marceau and Red Skelton concerts, since there was no distracting dialogue during their mime. The laugh box was later modernized into a laugh track with all different audience sounds. Home viewers were told not only when to chuckle, but when to gasp, to jeer, to go ooh and aww. Now, I just wonder if at Douglas's funeral, the priest had to play a cry track so mourners would know what to do. Seriously, though, in his life, Charlie Douglas managed the impossible. He gave people a million laughs and not one person pleasure. And that's the news gone by for April 27th, 2003. Please send your comments, your opinions, your pickled parsley to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062, or email us at davesgoneby@aol.com. We reserve the right to read your letters on the air, name withheld upon request, but we will give out your shoe size and social security number. That's Dave's Gone By, no apostrophe, at AOL.com, or snail mail, Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Please, no horror holes. I'm already married. Are you a member of the Rotary Club, the Hadassah, the Elks? Big deal. Why not join something really cool for a change? The Bystanders Club, the official Dave's Gone By fan club. Bystanders get a weekly special email, a bi-monthly newsletter devoted to the show, an autographed membership card eligible for discounts on show merchandise and local businesses, and a one-hour best-of audio tape with gems from the show and maybe even stuff we couldn't put on the radio. It's still just $10 to join. For the newsletter, the email, the best-of audio tape, for the cost of two porno magazines, and not even good ones, you can show your support for Dave's Gone By. Just make a $10 check or money order payable to Total Theater and send it to Total Theater, Box 62, that's 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. You can also join via PayPal, the email address davesgoneby@aol.com, davesgoneby@aol.com. Do you know what Long Island is doing Friday nights? No, not that. Long Island's Dating, a show for singles by that very singular personality, Bonnie D. Graham. Bonnie talks live with callers and guests about all facets of singlehood, sex, health, relationships, and sex. Bonnie's a comedian and TV host, so whatever your habitational status, check out Long Island's Dating Friday nights at 6 on WGBB. I need a man.
Every fall we pack our things and go. We know just how to time it, to find the proper climate, one that doesn't feature any snow. Cause when it snows you shiver, and it's difficult to fly. There isn't any food, which is another reason why. We go south for the winter, south for the winter.
But we're back, and time for Dave's Gone Cultural, the segment where we look at the arts, everything from film to books to theater. Tonight, reviews of three new Broadway musicals. And we begin, we were just hearing a clip from A Year with Frog and Toad, which is totally a children's play, so you have to go into it knowing that it might be fun, and adults are certainly, I think, going to enjoy it, but it is targeted towards rather young audiences. The music is by Robert Reel, and he wrote the whole thing. He wrote the book and the lyrics, too, based on apparently very famous and well-beloved books by Arnold Lobel. Funny, I never remember reading those when I was a kid. And it's a sweet little thing, small, and a lot of the critics got onto it for that, because the top ticket prices are $91 for this, and at first, you start thinking, well, you know, it's not fair to judge a show by how much it costs, because good is just good, even if it were $1,000 or $5. But you do figure on Broadway, a cast of five, a rather small-scale musical, you know, where is that money really going? Doesn't have to be that much, especially if you're taking a bunch of kids, but I'm sure their tickets are a lot less. Anyway, the point is, it's a charming little musical made up of little stories, little almost one-act playlets with music. Kind of nice that they don't all have morals. Some of them are just cute, some of them are just there for a laugh, there's a ghost story, and then there is the undercurrent of this abiding friendship between Frog, played by the terrific Jay Goad, and Marklin Baker, doing his usual and very delightful Marklin Baker as Toad, and they're good buddies. They don't seem to have any girlfriends, so I don't know what their subtext is, because they sleep in the same place, and they're always seeing each other. Actually, they'll sleep in the same place. They wake each other up. But anyway, there's almost no overriding plot. It's a little kid's cute, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. I felt when I first started that I was going to have a problem with it, because not that it was too loud, but it was over-miked for what it was, as so much of Broadway is. And I thought, oh, you don't have to do this. You don't have to make it sound big if it's good. But it grows on you, and there's a rather touching scene between Frog and Toad in the first act, but they don't go for tears, and they don't try to milk this big sad thing. Again, it's for young kids. There's also a very rousing song about cookies. And yes, they do sell cookies at intermission, so there's a tie-in. It makes me feel a little hinky about that, but oh, all right. And yes, when I went to see the show, I saw the actor's nightmare in the very, not the last scene, but the penultimate scene, a clock that Frog gives to Toad as a holiday Christmas gift fell apart on stage, and they had to make do with it and carry it around in their hands and keep referring to it. Again, where is that $91 going? But anyway, as I said, the lead actors are quite charming, and so are the supporting actors. Danielle Furland, who's a bit of a veteran of these things, Jennifer Gambattis, they play all sorts of things like moles and birds and supporting characters, and the big audience, not draw, but their favorite, seems to be Frank Vlasnik, who gets a lot of laughs out of just playing a little snail who has to deliver mail, one little letter, to poor, lonely Toad. So let's listen to Frank Vlasnik singing his song about delivering the letter.
A letter, a most important letter, a letter that was written by Frog. I'm traveling so fast, I'm assuming you're a guest, or at the very least you are a gog. I'm the snail with the mail, I'll deliver without fail, pardon the cloud of dust. I'm speeding with an envelope as fast as any antelope, forward and onward I thrust.
Forward and onward we thrust with Dave's Gone Cultural, and to a very different entity from the children-oriented year with Frog and Toad, the revival of the musical Nine, Tony-winning musical with a book by Arthur Copit, adapted into an Italian play by Mario Frati, and then put forward into a musical with a score by Maury Yeston, best known for the recent Titanic, not the movie, the Tony-winning Broadway show. And now, of course, this has gotten a bit of attention because it's the Broadway debut of Antonio Banderas as Guido Contini, who is an Italian film director, world famous and a national source of pride, but also coming off three flop films. And he has to start shooting his newest film in a week. He's got a producer who's laid out $1 million lira for it, or dollars for it. But the problem is, he doesn't have a script, he doesn't even have an idea. So he drags his wife on vacation to an Italian spa and tries to come up with something, thinks in terms of just everything he sees there, and fashions a film about Casanova. But so much starts going wrong, and all these women who are in his life start cropping up at all the wrong moments. He contemplates suicide, and that's the whole show, really. And as such, there is a problem with it being kind of a non-story. We're supposed to essentially focus on Guido and his wife, Luisa, and we get them as individuals. We see his needs and his childishness and childlike state, and we understand her, that she kind of gave up a whole lot to be with him, but we don't really see them much as a couple. Banderas is very charming. He does the very sweet little boyish thing delightfully, and he does have that magnetism, and Mary Stuart Masterson plays Luisa, which a role Karen Akers did in the original production, and she is quite good and quite competent and capable and also charming, again, as individuals. I didn't quite buy them that much as a couple, though. The good thing about 9 is that it really feels sophisticated rather than cartoonish or pop artish-y, as so many other musicals do now, including the good ones, like Hairspray, etc. And the performers, of course, some of them. Jane Krakowski has gotten all the attention basically because she comes down from the ceiling, but dozens of feet in the air, really, basically hanging from a long towel and is just essentially a towel around her, and she manages to sing and be terribly sexy. So if you've seen her in Ally McBeal and I remember her playing Flemmchen when Grand Hotel was playing, she is really something to see, and we watch her more than pretty much anyone else. We also get good work from Laura Benanti, who came to Broadway in Swing and then in Into the Woods. And one of the nice things is, sort of concurrent, almost by coincidence, with this revival, is that Columbia Broadway Masterworks, a division of Sony Music, has reissued the original cast recording from 1982 with Raul Julia and Karen Akers playing the husband and wife. And this time they've put it on 2 CDs. They've really expanded it with extra stuff, including Maury Yeston, the composer, singing on the demos. Anita Morris was playing the role now played by Jane Krakowski. The good part of it, of course, is that in some ways the original stars were indelible. In the bad way, Raul Julia and, at that time, Karen Akers both had some vocal trouble, and their pitch could be off. So we're going to listen, in fact, to Karen Akers, who at certain points is absolutely one of the most glorious, beautiful voices in the world, and then she'll miss a few notes, but the song really gets you. It's early in the show. She's fending off paparazzi and saying, "Look, I'm married to him. My husband makes movies."
The rumor that your marriage is in jeopardy?
None whatsoever.
What about your husband's friendship with Carla Albanese?
My husband has many friends.
When was the last time you saw Claudia Nardi?
I have no idea.
3 years ago in Mallorca.
That was gossip.
But compromising photographs were published in Il Giorno.
They were composites. We won a lawsuit in that case.
But in the public mind.
Oh, please. When will you understand? My husband makes movies. To make them, he lives a kind of dream in which his actions aren't always what they seem. He may be on to some unique romantic theme. Some men catch fish, some men tie flies, some earn their living baking bread. My husband, he goes a little crazy, making movies instead. My husband spins fantasies, he lives them, then gives them to you all. When he was working on the film on ancient Rome, he made the slave girls take the gladiators home. Some men buy stocks, some men punch clocks, some leap where others fear to tread. My husband, as author and director, makes up stories in his head. Contini, Luisa Contini, number one genius and number one fan. Guido Contini, Luisa Contini, daughter of well-to-do Florentine clan. Long ago, 20 years ago, once the names were Guido Contini, Luisa Delforno, actress with dreams and a life of her own, passionate, wild, and in love in Livorno, singing with Guido all night on the phone. Oh. someone else ago. Oh, he needs me so, and he'll be the last to know. My husband makes movies to make them. He makes himself upset. He works for weeks on end without a bit of rest. No other way can he achieve his level best. Some men read books, some shine their shoes, some retire early when they've seen the evening news. My husband only rarely comes to bed. My husband makes movies instead. My husband makes movies.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Contini.
Broadway, off-Broadway, cabaret. These are magical words conjuring up a universe of great entertainment. If you want to know everything about what's happening on the stages of New York, you need to get Performing Arts Insider magazine. For 60 years, Performing Arts Insider has been a bible of the industry. It tells you when shows are opening and closing, what they're about, who's in it, designers, writers, composers, contacts for producers and managers, box office info, parental guides, everything you need to know if you care about theater, opera, and dance too. As the chief editor of Backstage put it, Performing Arts Insider is who, what, where, and when, all the facts at your fingertips. For more information, how to subscribe or get a sample issue, call 516-295-1511 or go to www.totaltheater.com and click on Performing Arts Insider. Welcome back to the closing minutes of Dave's Gone By. Not going to really have time to talk about Urban Cowboy. I did mention it last week, but I did want to say, even though the critics excoriated it, it is lively, it is colorful, it tells a story, although certainly not a great one, and I guess the reason to watch it is for the sexy cast of dancers, and there's fun choreography, and I feel kind of good about the show because I saw a lousy workshop of it about 2 years ago when they were first trying to get producers to bring it to Broadway and investors. And I left at intermission. I was like, this is dull. They're just throwing in country songs wherever they can. And it's a dumb story. Blah. Well, what do you know? They really did improve it. And they have... Remember how I said that Antonio Banderas and Mary Stuart Masterson, although they're delightful apart, don't really have that much chemistry together? Well, Kavanaugh and Kalela, the two leads of Urban Cowboy, do have a bit of that sense. And what other nice thing about when I last saw the show is it has a real please-come feel to it at the end of the show. The cast comes out and they said, look, acknowledging that the reviews were harsh, and they're saying, we want to keep going, you seem to like it, and the audience did, and so I wish them well. I had a pretty good time, and then for the roundup of the shows I reviewed today, Urban Cowboy, 3 stars, 3 stars for 9, and 3 stars for Frog and Toad. No big must-sees among the three of them, but they're very different, quite entertaining musicals for different audiences and tastes. And Yahoo for that. Now, we're going to ride the big old mechanical bull out of here in a couple of minutes. Hope y'all enjoyed tonight's show, our 30th episode. My thanks, as always, to the WGBB May Queen, station manager Joey, and to the man with the bustle in his hedgerow, engineer Paul. Thanks also to engineer Tom for letting me take the reins the other night and be on the other side of the soundboard, a real trial by fire and a great learning experience. Thank you also to the press folks at Sony Music, Bolo Brian Brown, the Pete Sanders Group, and Barlow Hartman for their help in the Dave's Gone cultural segment. And of course, thank you to my wife, Joyce, for sharing all I do and tolerating all I don't. Just a reminder that if you liked the program, please show your appreciation by becoming a member of the Bystanders Club. $10 makes you a member. Lunch money, $10, gets you the newsletter, discount card, autograph, and of course, the best of audio tape. Find find out more by going to our website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By, or emailing davesgoneby@aol.com. I will be at the station after the show for the next half hour, so if you want to ask me questions directly off the air, call me at the station, 516-955-1240, 955-1240. And if you're interested in advertising or sponsorship, you can also give me a call after the show at 516-955-1240. Lots of opportunities, lots of reasons to share your company with our listeners. And if you don't want to call and you don't have a computer, you can write me an old-fashioned letter. Or a newfangled letter. I'm easy. Write to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. If you have a computer, the phone number, address, and a whole bunch of other stuff is on the show's website, including how to buy cassettes of previous episodes, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. If you forget the URL, just Google search Dave's Gone By, and we're right up top. And don't forget to check out other shows on this wildly eclectic radio station. There's Joe Salzone Live, Saturdays at 7:30. Entertainment Long Island, 7 o'clock on Sundays, right before Dave's Gone By. Friday nights at 6, it's Long Island's Dating with Bonnie D. Graham. Sunday nights at 10, an hour from now, it's Rap, Hip Hop, and Soul on Real Time Radio. And at 11, it's usually Midnight Madness, I'm not sure if that's on tonight, hosted by Mike Artsis. Mike has a bunch of shows on the station, so do check them all out. And that, speaking of checking out, is Dave's Gone By for this week, April 27th, 2003. I'll be back next Sunday night, 8 p.m. on WGBB AM 1240 and live streaming on the net at WGBB.com. My guest will be theater critic and chair of the theater department at Hunter College, Jonathan Kalb, plus more theater reviews. It's spring, everything's opening up, so we're doing a lot of theater. Plus the news gone by, of course, and some other non-theater stuff, too. So until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz. Good night. Mayday, mayday. 4 days away. And gone by. Thank you.